Aye. To look at it from, I don't know, whether it's right is good and left is bad. Many people are right-handed. People are more comfortable that way. So the desire for those who want to be right, that is the result, that will be a good result for those who desire things for their own pleasure. It will lead to destructive consequences. So, let's go ahead and read this verse and notice from now to the end of this chapter. Let's go ahead and read this. Sign this first, and then I'll talk about it. So first, before we read this, what is the picture you see here? What's the illustration that this author is using? So this is talking about a farmer. Now, let's take a moment to review. Is Proverbs a book of promises? No. It's a book of principles, tendencies. It's a book of wisdom. Now, we've talked about what this set is. Now, talking about scattering, but increasing. You scatter, but you still gain profit. What is that? You give, and then you receive more. Now, there are two different pictures here. If I'm a farmer, say I'm growing corn, and I live in Kansas, you know, there you have a lot of corn here, okay? So, I plant the corn. Grows and I harvest the corn. There's more than two different kinds of corn, but usually we think about two different kinds. There's field corn and then there's sweet corn. So you go to the store and you buy corn, a package, that's sweet corn. Field corn is what they give to animals. They use it for save some for the winter. I put it in the ground so I can reap a second harvest, even more corn. It's not enough to plant it, I have to replant it. So I can get even more. So, some people use it winter, during the winter, and some people save it otherwise, I'd have to go to the seed store and plant, and get more seed to plant. So, I find, back then they didn't have seed stores, so they have saved seed for the next planting. So scatter it and yet increase it. So this applies to you. What are you talking about? What's the point? Investing in what? Spreading the word to others. Your time, your talent, your skills now. If I hold back too much, withhold it more than is meet, more than I, you know, if I withhold too much, I save too much. I don't want to do that. Leads to poverty. Why? Because in the spring when I come to plant, I fall. I've saved too much. person do I want to be? A saver or a spender? And I think a saver might be best, and sometimes that's good to say things, right? It's good to say things. It's good to say things. Sometimes I think you say too much. Because we're worried about the future. We're worried about what's going to happen. I better hold on to it. I better save it. And we don't invest it as much as we should. We don't give to people. We don't use what we have enough. So I use this example, what I'm talking about specifically as we go on. Now, here we're continuing with the same concept here. The liberal soul, the one who keeps giving, will be made fat. Now, today's culture in America, mostly in the Western world, we have writing this about being more liberal. Just more, and if you give more, you gain more profit back. You become fat by being generous. And notice this in the picture again. If you water, you will be watered as well. He that withholdeth corn, people shall curse him, but blessing shall be upon the head of him who sells it. In verse 27, he that diligently seeketh good procureth favor, people love it, but he that seeketh mischief, it shall come to him. And it's more about profit here. The goal is to get money, and he doesn't care about the people who live around him. All he wants is his money. He wants to hold on to his money. So, remember, we were thinking about Judas. Money was his only goal. He would rather sell out his friend for 30 pieces of silver. Now, that's what you want. You'll get punishment. You'll get trouble for it. So that's the picture. How does this apply to our lives specifically? I'll give you two or three examples. First of all, involving money. If I have some money, says I have a good amount of money, and I'm holding on to it, and I don't use my money for the Lord. Use it to invest in other opportunities. I just hold it. It's same, like the same picture of the New Testament, the story that Jesus told about the man who had the people who had 10 talents and 5 talents and 1 talent. The those who had 10 and 5 talents invested them and gained even more money. The one who had 1 talent and buried his talent and refused to use it. And the master came back and he dug it up and brought it back to him and said, here is your talent that you gave me. I give it back to you. And what Jesus says, he was called wicked, lazy. You knew I had expectations of more. You knew I was expecting more from you. I wanted growth. And it's the same way when the Lord gives you financial ability and you withhold it. Now maybe some of you don't have any financial ability, but those of you who have it, sometimes withhold it. And you refuse to use it. I work hard for this money, it's mine. Who gave you the ability to work hard? Who gave you the ability to wake up? Who gave you the mind and the skills to do it? Who gave you the opportunity of living in America where you're free to work? But it's mine. So be careful. You're not going to succeed. Run. I know some people who are selfish in the future. They don't use it, what they say. So I'm not telling you not to save money. Please don't misunderstand. Saving is important. I have a savings account. But I also have another account that I try to use to give from. It's an opportunity for investment. And so that's financially, and also for your skills. Many people say, well, I don't have many talents. But you have many abilities. Everyone has abilities. All of you have God-given abilities. And you may not think so, but you do. And if you think only of yourself, that I'm not going to use my skills, I'm going to use them for me. I'm going to use my skills for my own success. Not to help other people and not to use them for the Lord. Shame on you. Why? Because it leads to trouble. And it leads to people disliking you, avoiding you. I know you have the ability to do this. Can you do it? You say no. Push them away. So be careful. And Solomon, again, this is not a promise. Remember that. It's not a promise. That if you give money, your bank account, you know, if you take everything out of your bank account and give it away, are you going to expect money back? No, you should be wise about that too. And understand how to invest properly. But I'm going to encourage you to think about what you're saving. It's good to save, but also you have opportunities to give to other people. An opportunity to be a giver. The Bible talks about God loves a cheerful giver. So it's important that we do that as well. So, still related to the same topic. He that trusteth in his riches shall fall, but the righteous shall flourish as a branch. Now, this is kind of cool. I love this picture. Now, first, you see in verse 28, it looks opposites, right? The righteous versus the wicked, the just versus the lawless, the good versus the wicked. So there are obvious opposites. I teach my kids, what is the opposite of white is black? What's the opposite of hot? Cold. So we teach our kids opposites. And the first thing you see, it looks like an opposite. He that trusteth in his riches and the righteous. Now, is money bad? I remember a verse in the New Testament that says, Jesus says, money is the root of evil. No, doesn't say that. That's not the verse. I see people say, no, that's good. You know that. You know your Bible. What does the verse say? The love of money is the root of all evil. The opposite here is what? There are two opposing faiths, right? You have a choice. Righteousness means your trust is where? Your faith is where? If I'm righteous, where is my faith? In God. If I have my faith in money, if I trust in money, money and myself. I have faith in myself that I can make it. I know I can handle my money well, and I know what to do. I'm wealthy, I'm a millionaire or a billionaire. I can take care of myself. I don't need God. And that's why Jesus says it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a wealthy man to get into heaven. So understand where we have our faith. We trust in money. It's not the same as having faith in God. I can be righteous and wealthy. I can be. Joseph Arimathea was a wealthy man, but he loved Jesus, and he followed him. There's nothing wrong with money. Where is your faith? Verse 29, he that troubleth his own house shall inherit the land, and the fool shall be servant to the wise of heart. Now, I recently had a conversation with somebody. I have one son who is a problem. Has sinned. He's living in sin. And they asked me what to do. Well, I can pray with him, encourage him, counsel him. And he asked me, I'm thinking of kicking him out of my house. Well, that's your choice. Money. You decide what to do with it, but that's a picture. Have you ever heard a family rejecting one person, kicking them out? When I die, I don't give them anything in my will. Nothing. The wind, so to speak. Is that what you want? No, you want to inherit money. So they're depressed. Because it caused trouble. So, this is the last verse that we'll talk about. So, and it all ties together. Verse 30. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. And that winneth souls is wise. Behold, the righteous. righteous shall be recompensed in the earth, much more the wicked and sinner. Now, please, do not use Proverbs 11, verse 30 for the sake of the people. Please don't do that. This verse is not about witnessing at all. And then people see this word, winneth souls. Oh, that means we're going to go out and win souls. Have you ever heard that before? You can hear it phrase anyway. That verse is not about that. That verse is about the ability to bring people myself, if I follow the Lord, if I'm righteous, I'm like a tree of life. What does that mean? I have a lot of people wanting things from me. People should be flocking to me because I'm righteous and I have fruit to offer. My fruit come from? Where is my fruit coming from? From God. How do I get it? The Holy Spirit in the New Testament. Right. But Solomon didn't have that experience. In the Word of God, that's good. And what else? From prayer. And what else? Love. God, I spend time with God, and then after I leave His presence, people should notice that I have fruit. Again, I sign it like this. It's the fruit as evidence. So that people can look at me and know that I have something to offer. Not from myself, but from God. They look at me, they want what I have, and they it can draw people to me. If I don't have it, either I'm a dried up Christian or I'm not saved. Do people want what I have? No. They look at me and they see something dry, or something that won't save them. And so they don't want what you have. You have no evidence, nothing to show, no fruit of a changed life. They won't be attracted by what you have. Oh, so you're talking about soul winning. It can sort of apply, but really, it relates to all the verses that came before it. It's talking about producing. Planting, watering. The end result is a tree of life. A tree that goes on. Corn is different. The corn, after a year, you have to replant it. You have to go back and plant it again. And it grows all over again. But the tree, every year, and it keeps producing. So which one is better? Be changing things every year, or do stay strong and stable every year like a tree? That tree stop watering a tree, what happens? It'll wither and die. If you neglect it, it won't work. You have to take care of it and protect it. If it's cold, you know, cold spell can kill it. So, in verse 30, again, this is not a promise, not a guarantee. The righteous shall be recompensed. What does this mean? Re means again. Compense means what? Pay. So sometimes we talk about HR compensation. It's talking about money. What they pay you back. So behold, the righteous shall be recompensed in the earth. Oh, really? Much more the wicked and the sinner. So what is Solomon talking about here? As Christians, we have the opportunity to work, to serve. And we have a heavenly reward. But Solomon's not talking about your heavenly reward. His understanding of heaven was limited. But you have the opportunity to work for God. You'll win a heavenly reward. And we have, the New Testament tells us, when we work and serve the Lord, he will say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joys of the Lord. And that's wonderful. Hooray! That's what we want. I want to hear that someday when I get to heaven. But also, we have rewards on earth. Work. We follow the Lord, and I'm not preaching prosperity gospel. If you follow Jesus, you're going to get rich. I'm not preaching that. You know, my friend down in Texas preaches that. I watch him on TV. You can watch it too. Right, he's my best buddy. We're on a first name basis, Joel. But understand, again, this isn't a promise. It's not a guarantee. But when you follow the Lord, he takes care of us. He makes sure that we succeed and more than others who don't follow the Lord. We see good results. And maybe not in our bank account, lives. We see that we're different when we follow the Lord. We feel joy. We see the result of our faith. And God blesses us far more than those who don't follow him. And they can receive blessings too. The rain falls on the just and the unjust, but it might rain on the just a little bit more. So I encourage you to understand from the Bible perspective that we must invest faithfully and be involved in his work and serving him. And if we neglect it, that means the result is our own, we seek our own self-pleasure, and the result of that is trouble, mischief. So I encourage you to keep working and serving the Lord with your heart and your life. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, remind us from the book of Proverbs of the value of following you. No one is righteous. I read this and sometimes I laugh a little bit because Solomon wrote about himself being not unrighteous. Lord, we know that we have found righteousness. We are found righteous in you. And we continue to follow you and serve you and be involved in what and desire you. And the result of that is that we have righteousness. We have the ability to invest, the ability to be liberal, the ability to water others so they can water us. And people will look at us as a tree of life with roots planted and standing firm. May others look at us and enjoy the fruits. And let us not forget that you have a burden for us. We should not just try to depend solely on ourselves and what we can do. And on our own wealth and abilities. And on our own governments. And we forget about you. I know some people say, oh, I trust in my government pension.